Hi everybody, welcome to Building an Enterprise Container Platform. Let's show the presenters. Hi guys, I'm Robert Hartveld. And with me would be Kenneth.
Yes, Kenneth here. For some reason, my camera just got blocked, even though we tested this 20 minutes ago. But I'm here. Hi.
Hi, Kenneth. Can you do a short round of introductions, please?
Of course. Who should start?
Yeah, I'm happy to start. Maybe you can find an issue with Wiretalk. So I'm Robert Hartveld. I'm the pre-sales of Mirantes in Northern Europe, and I'm actually based in the Netherlands. I have a background in cloud computing and in big data also. You can find me on LinkedIn. And yeah, happy when you connect to me.
Yeah, and my name is Kenneth Albersson. I'm the CTO of Conoa, and I am also doing a lot of teaching and training in Mirantes products and Kubernetes per se.
And you're a partner of us, right?
Definitely, and I have a few slides as well that I'm going to share with you.
Go ahead then, Kenneth, take it away.
I will do so. Can you see my screen?
Yes, we can.
Well, so Conoa is a company that works with cloud-native technologies. As I mentioned, I'm CTO, and I do a lot of teaching and talking with our customers around these technologies. We basically help our customers transition from traditional infrastructure to a more cloud-native focused infrastructure. So we work a lot with microservices, containers, Kubernetes, pipelines, and we work both in the public cloud and on-prem, building the customer's private clouds. We do this by offering both professional services, product solutions, and training. We are a member of the Cloud Native Computing Foundation, which is very important for us because this organization is maintaining a lot of the relevant products and projects based around the ecosystem of Kubernetes. And they have created this landscape map, and I'm sure a few of you guys have seen this already, but I think this is a really interesting but still overwhelming picture. This shows us that there is a lot of technologies to understand and to implement if we're going to implement a container-based platform. Kubernetes and containers is one thing, but there are so many more products that we need to understand. And another way of looking at this is looking at this picture. When you typically need to implement a Kubernetes platform, you have to make a lot of choices. And it all starts with the underlying infrastructure. Are we going to build this on-prem? Are we going to build this in the cloud? Or are we going to build our own OpenStack environment to build this on? Which operating systems are we going to support? Is it sufficient to only support Linux, or do we need to support Windows as well? And which kind of Linux distributions do we want to support, and so on? And depending on which choice you make in one box, that can influence or limit the number of choices in another box. It all started with Docker a few years ago, but today there are more options when it comes to the actual container engine itself as well. And when it comes to the orchestrator, we have two major orchestrators today. One is obviously Kubernetes, which has become the de facto standard for orchestration. But still, we have a lot of Windows-based customers that are still running Docker Swarm as their orchestrator. Regardless of which orchestrator you're using, you need a secure registry to build to place your two images on, because Kubernetes needs to pull all those images from somewhere in order to orchestrate the containers in the platform. And then when it comes to Kubernetes itself, you have a lot of choices when you're going to implement your own Kubernetes platform. You can build this on 100% free and open source based software. I mean, and you can also purchase a pre-built or pre-packaged Kubernetes platform to start with. And regardless on how you implement and how you build the Kubernetes platform, you still need a software repository to collect and build your container images from. You need a pipeline or use your existing pipeline. You need to think about how you're going to access all your containers within your cluster from the outside. Which kind of network ingress are you going to use? You need a way to monitor all these applications and all these containers. All containers have their own container logs, and you need a good way to centralize and collect all those logs to one place. You need some kind of persistent storage for your containers that actually needs to save state. And all these boxes needs to be highly secured. Your Docker images needs to be secure. Your running images and running containers need to be secure. And all the steps and all the boxes need to be as secure as possible. And on top of everything, you can implement a service mesh and start giving your developers a more serverless kind of experience of your platform. And obviously, all these boxes have different options. And here we can see some of the options available. This is by no means complete list or logotypes of different solutions. But it does show us that even though we talk about Kubernetes, and even though we talk about implementing a container platform or a Kubernetes platform, there is a lot of choices and options that we need to consider and make a decision on. And as I mentioned, you can do this with 100% free software, and you can do all this by yourself, or you could rely on a pre-built and pre-packaged and pre-tested platform to start with. And the platform from Mirantis is a great platform, a secure, highly scalable platform to start with. And this is where Robert is going to show you much more on what Mirantis can do to help us solve many of these problems and challenges for us. So I will stop sharing my screen, Robert, and maybe you can take it from here.
I think I already did. Thanks, Kenneth. So as Kenneth mentioned, there are a lot of moving parts, and basically we're not needing a drill. We need a reliable platform which can orchestrate your business applications, right? it's all about your business applications, which are now cloud native and need to be run on your production platform. So what Mirantis is all about is ship your code faster. So as Kenneth explained, there are a lot of moving parts. There are a lot of choices to be made, and we basically made one platform which is ready to go, which brings you simplicity, a secure platform, and still gives you a lot of choice, right? So if you want to have other choices, we will talk to that, what possibilities we have. So we're all about you focus on your business application, and we focus on the platform so it's ready to go. And the first product what does this is what we call Mirantis Container Cloud. And basically this runs your OpenStack traditional workload. On the left side, you can see OpenStack. And we can also build a Kubernetes platform. So it handles both sides, both traditionally workloads as cloud native application workload. And it keeps the complexity away from you, right? So if you're building a Kubernetes platform, I did that in AWS before I joined Mirantis. You have to take care of a VPC. You have to create subnets. You have to create net instances. You need to create tags, which has to be very specific. All that complexity, you don't want to do that because it's a lot of work, also a lot of work to maintain. And basically, it should be easy so everybody can create your own stack which they need, a Kubernetes cluster or an OpenStack. So that's exactly what we're doing. So in the middle, you see Mirantis Container Cloud, and that product can build both an OpenStack environment as a Kubernetes environment for you. And we can run that on bare metal, on VMware, on AWS, or Equinix. And soon we will also run this on Azure and on Google Cloud. So a lot of choices which you can do. For your platform, the end result will always be the same. So it's, for you, it's one platform. And underneath, we take care of all the complexity of the infrastructure. So it's all about simplicity. And this also goes for your DevOps team. So you have developers who wants to develop quickly. And we have operators who should take this in production. And then the cycle, the DevOps cycle, as you all know it, goes in one hand and to the other hand. So this is also where Container Cloud can help you, because it not only has a Kubernetes platform we're talking about today, but it also provides you a second day operations, monitoring, logging, alarming, that kind of things. So it also makes your life from your operators easy. Everything which you need is already in this platform, and your developers could, if they have permission, obviously, create with a self-service, can create a cluster. Well, let me show you how easy this is and how simple we take the complexity out of the equation. You can see the self-service on the right. You see here, create cluster. It's very easy. You give it how many worker nodes you want to have and how many master nodes you want to have, and it creates it for you. All the complexity is done in the background. And once it's ready, you will see it when it's ready. It shows up here somewhat bigger. It's ready and shows that all the components are available to you. So everything is done automatically without you seeing that. All the complexity is hide from you. So why is this important? This is important so you can immediately go and develop and also have a second day operations. So you don't have to focus on the Kubernetes platform itself. We will take care of that for you. We have tested this. We have brought all the open source projects together to work with each other and fully support the stack. So you can just build your applications and run them. So it's not only that you can create a cluster very easy, but how many customers spend a lot of time and with the best of your people to just upgrade a platform once you have it. I hear a lot of customers doing this for days and weeks at once. So we want you to develop your business application. And in the middle, you can see it has an error. It's like an iPad blinking. I have an upgrade for you. and then you on the right click cluster upgrade or upgrade cluster, and then it will run the upgrade for you in the background. And obviously when that's stuck, we can help you with our support, because we tested this before and we have done this multiple times already. So the cluster can seamlessly upgrade, so you can spend time on your applications. Also, I mentioned second day support, like monitoring. Operators want to see what's happening, and it's very complex for the, when you see this Kubernetes, as it's, Kenneth said, a lot of moving parts, a lot of projects which you need to focus on. So we bring you a single pane of glass for operations. You can beam this to your wall. You can have alerting on this and alarms going off. You can get emails when something goes wrong. Everything is customizable here. This is built on Grafana, as you, some can tell, and it's completely customizable. Another day, other thing for operations is that you can find something back, because I see a lot of logs and they're everywhere, right? They are in your containers and they're, the puzzle is hard to crack. But we collect all the logging already in the platform for you, and we have a simple interface, a Kibana interface to those logs. So everything is there, and with the Kibana SQL-like syntax, you can easily find things back. So as you can see here, I search on something like Cube, and then it finds, it highlights us already where that is coming from and when it was happening on which computer. So this is out of the box. We also added queries to this, but you can obviously build your own. It's still flexible. So this is makes it far more easier to solve your puzzles when something goes wrong or you're looking for something in your logging. So how about choice? We not always want the same size of a hole. So what can we do there? Well, we put all those things together. So the batteries are included. When you have this platform, everything is there. Like we have a CNI already chosen for you. But maybe you want to do another CNI or you want to do another open source project, and that's fine by us. So everything is compliant to the cloud native computing foundation standards. So it's swappable very easily. So yes, we understand that there are other open source tools which you want to use, and we're happy for you to do that. So if we have chosen for STO, but if you want to use NGINX, fine by us, right? It all ends up in the hopefully well-known Mirantis Kubernetes engine. This was formerly known as the Docker Universal Control Plane. So in 2019, Mirantis took over Docker. So we rebranded our naming. So the currently the name is Mirantis Kubernetes Engine. And this is the famous engine, which allows you to run both Swarm as Kubernetes. So we know the market is highly adopting Kubernetes. So we have a Kubernetes platform to the Kubernetes standards, but we still, and we can still do, and we're still investing also in Swarm technology. So this whole MKE clusters is built by best practices, right? We already set it up. It's high available. Everything is out of the box, is ready for you to use it. Let's talk about job zero, guys, security. Security, you should build it from on the start, right? If you're gonna do drilling, then you need safety first. So what does it mean for us? We have built a secure software supply chain. So how does this work? The developer on the left, he's obviously building images with Docker, and he is placing them on the Mirantis Secure Registry, formerly known as Docker Trusted Engine, I believe. Registry, of course, yeah. So what we can do there is we can put an option on and then scan this on a vulnerability. And this is how it looks like. So in the Mirante Secure Registry, it's a software engine which can hold your images, right? And I call it a parking lot for images. And I think it is good practice to install your Mirante Secure Registry in a local data center. So your images are always at your own local data center because you're placing your applications there, which are business applications, which are your crown jewels, guys. So why would you place them in the middle of the city square, right? Keep your vault safe in your own data center. And what we then add is that we can automatically scan images once they are pushed to this platform. So we enable, and you see this here in yellow, we enable on push. And as soon as the developer pushes an image to this registry, it will automatically be scanned on known vulnerabilities. So we update our database a few times a day. And then we scan the images which come in against the then known vulnerability scan. And hopefully it will say no vulnerabilities found, but I found out that there actually are a lot of vulnerabilities which I wouldn't know if I didn't have this product. So yeah, it's safe. And now at least now I'm aware of my risk there, right? I know that the LibSecCom has a critical vulnerability and I can do something about it. I even know in which layer that is added. It's in layer 1. So now I can change my image so I can bypass or make it more secure, patch it. So I can, the next time when I run this vulnerability scan, I can actually sign it off that it's safe. And that's the other thing. Once everything is safe, we can sign it off. We can make a sign off on approved images. And obviously, if you take that into your CI/CD pipeline, then we can scan the images, say it's safe, and then go back to the next level of the CI/CD pipeline, right? Get it into another quality test. So it builds trust when you're building your application. So that trust needs to be secured, and that's exactly what we do with MKE, so the Mirantis Kubernetes Engine. We can put on contact trust settings. We can put that on, and then it will only run images which has the signature of a certain team. So we can add a team here, as you can see underneath the yellow, and then it will only run images which have that signature of the team. So this prevents production from running rogue containers. No containers can run which are not checked. So this gives you an end-to-end security platform and takes care of job zero fully automatically. So not that you have to start thinking of security. We will do the vulnerability scan once you put in your first image. In the registry, we will sign it off. When it's signed off, we bring it further in the CI/CD pipeline. And if it's in the end of the CI/CD pipeline and goes into production, we will double check that the signatures are on there. And otherwise, we will just not run the image, which makes production safe and secure. So from a complete platform perspective, we discussed Mirantis Container Cloud, which basically builds either an OpenStack program up on Kubernetes, by the way, or a Kubernetes engine. And the Kubernetes engine runs the Mirantis container runtime. It's the Dockerd runtime. So that runs Docker. And OpenStack needs help of disks and volumes. So it uses SEP to create volumes for you in the platform. So now we have a platform where you can easily build an OpenStack and a Kubernetes engine environment, which also, by the way, runs Swarm, and have monitoring alerting and logging already there, and we do that by the open source project of Stacklight. And this can be done on any operating system, on any infrastructure, without you even knowing how everything works underneath the cover. We will take care of that for you. So let's reduce even more complexity, and we're going to talk about Lens, K0, and Obscure. So first off, Lens. Lens is an easy Kubernetes EDI, so it easily connects you to your Kubernetes cluster. So once you connect it, you can see, and you can see the events, you can see in graphical user interface what is happening, and you can also manipulate YAML files and create objects in Kubernetes very easily. So it's easy to scale and deployment up, for an example, just by clicking it in. So it already has a terminal which is connected to your Kubernetes platform, but it also makes it visible, and you can do it graphically if you want to. So I know a lot of hardcore Kubernetes guys like me probably uses the terminal by preference, but if you're not that command-like type of guy, then you can easily have more replicas of an image by just clicking on it and scale it on this way with a GUI. This is open source, guys. You can just download it today and start today with this. You can find a downloadable source from k8slens.dev, as you can see on the screen. And you can start today. It's free. And it's our gift to the open source. Another gift to the open source is K0. We just launched this. As you understand from Kenneth and me, Kubernetes has a lot of moving components, and it's very big, and we reduced it to just one executable. And please mind how powerful this is when you are in IoT or when you're in an edge location, right, where you cannot do much. Like my next project will be to install this on my Raspberry Pi and have a cluster running in a Raspberry Pi. It's that easy because it's just one executable and it's very easy to install. So from here, I want for all the not tech guys to close your eyes for 3 slides, please, because I will show how easy it is to create this, but it will involve some coding. So please close your eyes and I will wake you up in 3 slides. So first off, when you want to create a Kubernetes K0 platform, which is a zero friction Kubernetes in just one executable, you have to download it and install it, like you can see in the first command. And then you can actually see it's just one executable. And everything we will do will be doing with this executable, like everything. Again, this is all open source. You can just download it today and start playing with it today. It's very easy. It's the most easy way I have seen Kubernetes running because it's so easy with just one executable. And it's perfect for edge locations and zero friction Kubernetes, right? So to make a cluster running, you have to install a control plane. So that's done with the first command sudo and then run the executable install. Say you need a controller, you need one. So normally we would have to take 3, right, to make it more secure. But now I just took one. So you need a single executable, and then you have to start it, and it's there. That is how easy it is. We can check on status, and that's it. Let's add a worker node. Okay, so for a worker node, we first need to create a token for the worker node in the master node, so in the control node. So we say that we need a token create, and we put that for a role for a worker, and we put that in a temporary file. Obviously, we need to transfer this file to another host, and then we install the same executable on that other host. So you can tell this is another host. And then we can install the worker with that temporary token file. And then they know each other. They're automatically connected. I can start the worker and I can immediately do sudo k0s kubectl get nodes, and I get a response. And I can, from there on, I can make my deployments. I can make my pods, and everything is working. And I can add more nodes if I want to by doing exactly the same. So it's very, very easy. And as it is just one executable, it's very easy to place it anywhere you need Kubernetes. So nothing to hold you back on Kubernetes anymore. So for everybody who was closest, because it was not techie enough, please open them again. We're going to talk about OpsCare. So OpsCare is our support model, basically. We do LabsCare, ProdCare, and OpsCare. And OpsCare is your way to give even more to us. So it's not that we create your platform, but we will even manage your platform, and it will be a managed service for everything. So this way, you can really, really focus on your business outcome instead of building supporting your platform. Nobody will be having issues with your platform because we will take care of it. So you do focus on developing applications. We take care of your platform. This also solves your problem of finding a Kubernetes expert, which will then be very busy with working on a Kubernetes platform instead of building actual business applications. So we're here to help. We have done this for a lot of other customers, as you can tell on this slide. We are in different verticals, but this is my time to give some time back to Kenneth and let him talk about the way that Canoa does this. Kenneth, are you still online?
I'm online. Good. Still no camera though, so sorry about that.
No worries.
I mean, with all due respect, but everyone can show you a bunch of slides and tell them their product is best. But I have had the pleasure of working with Mirantis and their Kubernetes platform and Docker platform for many years now, and I can really say that it's really stable, and I really trust the platform. But I will, before doing that, I will let you know that implementing all this stuff, even though it's technically very easy to install a Kubernetes cluster, I mean installing the Mirantis Kubernetes engine is literally one command, and then you have a Kubernetes cluster up and running. But still, a lot of these projects takes months to complete. And that's because it's still a very new technology. So there's a lot of things to learn. And as both me and Robert told you, there's a lot of moving parts. Kubernetes is one thing. The storage is one thing, logging is one thing, networking is one thing. So we have, together with our customers, actually learned a process on how to approach this new technology. And we often start our journey together with the customer with a two-day discovery workshop, when we actually look at the stack picture I showed you earlier. Then we talk about all the boxes and all the layers, and then we talk about the challenges and the different options available in each box. And this is a two-day workshop, to be honest, just to get started. And this is also for all the different team members to to learn about this new technology. Then obviously we need to, together with the customer, we need to architect and design the project and cluster, and then do the actual implementation together with the customer. And one thing that is also often forgotten about is that once you have installed the platform, what do you do then? I mean, as I said, it takes 30 seconds to install a Mirantis Kubernetes engine, but what's next? We have found out that there is a lot of, even though the developers are generally technically very skilled, and often the driven factor of implementing these technologies, there is also a lot of developers that are great at coding, and they are great in developing their application, but they don't have the necessary skill to containerize the application and to actually put it in containers. So we have something called onboarding, which means that you need to spend a lot of time educating the internal developers and give them a process and maybe a template that can help them in literally putting their application inside a Docker image, because it has to be in a Docker image to be able to run in a Kubernetes environment. So we actually have quite a few really large installations here in Sweden, because we managed to together with the customer to really start using the platform and really learn the customer how to put all their applications and services into containers so that they can actually have something to run in the platform. And Robert, if you change the slide for me.
Yes.
Yes. Mirantis was, and to be honest, back in the days, it was actually Docker itself that Mirantis eventually acquired the product. We have been working with Docker / Mirantis since 2015, and we have learned the hard way how to implement this platform. And I can really, really say that I think this is a really stable and secure platform. We are running this on some of the largest banks in Sweden, as well as tele companies and insurers and industry companies. And this really, really works. We did, together with Docker Mirantis, a first really, really large scale implementation on Docker on Windows a few years ago. So we have really started from nothing basically, and learned this great platform together with other customers. As I said, when we get asked how should you build a Kubernetes platform, well, then I can really say that I know for a fact that the Mirantis platform really works, because we are running it for years on a lot of the biggest companies here in Sweden. We have one of our customers, he told me today that they are running 20,000 containers in their Mirantis platform. That's 3,000 services on 300 nodes divided on 10 clusters. I mean, that really means that you can trust the platform. So, seeing is believing. Maybe Robert can tell us more about how easy it is to download a demo and just get started.
Absolutely, I'm happy to show you a demo. So anybody who connects with me and requests a demo, yeah, let's talk. So, yeah. Anyway, can I take it over? Can I take it back?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, please do.
Okay. Thanks, Kenneth. So, don't trust us, right? Check for yourself. And there are really good articles, as you can see here, which already tells a lot about us and what we do. Also, this one just went out from G2, and that's on g2.com. You can look at it and read it. They are comparing us against AWS, which is always great. So, yeah. So please remember, we like you to develop business apps, which you then can easily bring into production. We're all about shipping code faster. Your developers can immediately work, and your operators can immediately monitor what is going on in the clusters. And it's very easy to build, when you have a new project, build a new cluster if you need one, right? So with that, I'm almost on the end. If you have questions, there is a question box which you can use now, or you can actually email us. So both our email addresses are here. Also, you can find me on LinkedIn, where you can connect to me. That's always nice. I got two questions in the question boards, which I will try to answer now. So question one is, how does Container maintain transactions for an application in case of load balancing? I think you mean that you need ingress rules. So either an application is stateful, as we call that. So it needs to maintain a connection to the same container and the same image to hold transaction. That's called stateful. And also, it's much better for in the new world to program in stateless, where it doesn't matter which container gets a turn, because it's basically not maintaining the connection status. So in order in Kubernetes to do that, you need to build an ingress rule, according to me. And then labels will connect it to the right containers. Is that correct, Kenneth? Do you have?
The basic, the easy question answer to the question, it doesn't. The container does not maintain any state. It's completely up to the application. So as you said, Robert, the easiest way is to, I mean, it's much easier to make a stateless application work out of the box in containerized workload. So there are no easy fixes here. So if you need state, that either the application needs to handle that, or you need to write ingress rules that handle the state for you.
Exactly. And the second question is, how do me, and it's probably we, measure if our Kubernetes cluster are cost effective? Well, I always recommend customers to maintain a business case for every application they write. So that means that you actually monitor if your business application is worth the money you're spending on it. What I hear from customers, and what I find always, what we also drive is do a fast implementation. So a first viable product, and then build that out. So build fast and be the first on the market, because that's where the marketer is looking for exciting new opportunities. Kenneth, you want to say anything about that?
Yeah, definitely. This is one of the most common questions we get from the customers, especially the large customers, because internal chargeback and is also associated to the question. How do you charge your internal customers for the usage, and how do you measure if it's cost effective? I have one customer that actually made an internal investigation. And obviously, this is easy for me to say, but it's a true story. They have literally seen that they are saving 50% in development time and compared to the traditional development for one particular application. So our customers have really seen the benefit of containerizing their workload. But as I said, I cannot share you which customer or the details, so it's just words, so you just have to trust on this one. But this can be measured, but the most easy thing would be to compare your traditional platform with your new Kubernetes cluster and do the math yourself.
Yes, and what I also want to tell is you can basically choose where you want to pin this to the core infrastructure. So we can do it either on vSphere, which you already have in-house, or you can run it on AWS, where you obviously can do reserved instances, which double downs the price of a Kubernetes cluster. So any other questions which we can answer now? Now we are here anyway. Otherwise, I think I will bring back you like 10 minutes because we're on the end of our presentation. I will put your screen on, Kenneth. Just be warned. Yeah.
Yeah. Still no camera. Oh, unfortunately. I don't know what happened because, we did share you our contact information. So yes. Please don't hesitate to reach out if you have any questions that you think we could help you answer or get you started or show you and point you into the right direction. So, yeah.
Don't be a stranger, guys. Connect to us and we will bring you forward. All right. With that, I think I'm going to end the presentation here.
Okay. Thank you, Robert.
Thank you very much. Cheers. Bye, guys.